In this new lecture, we will discuss the main emphasis will be on the gastric polyps. But before gastric polyps, these are the two important hypertrophic gastropathies. Just a brief overview of these two gastropathies: Menetrier disease and Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, that is also called as ZD syndrome. Menetrier disease, basically it is a very rare disorder, and that is associated with excessive secretion of the growth factor. As a result of excessive secretion of the growth factor, there occurs foveolar cell hyperplasia, hypoproteinemia. That hypoproteinemia is basically due to protein losing enteropathy. The symptoms, they include weight loss, edema and diarrhea. Edema that occurs due to hypoproteinemia. Risk of adenocarcinoma is there in case of Menetrier disease. When we talk about the morphology, this is the picture of a microscopic view of the Menetrier disease, in which there you can see these irregular enlargement of these gastric rugae. Some areas you can see they are appearing to be polypoid in nature, especially the central 3 villi and the 2 villi that are immediately adjacent to the central 3 villi. They are appearing, they are mimicking a polyp, so they can mimic a polyp. Histologically, the most important characteristic is the foveolar cell hyperplasia that is associated with this Menetrier disease. And this appearance of this irregular appearance of the glands, irregular enlargement or irregular appearance of these glands there, that is called as corkscrew arrangement. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, that is basically a gastric gastrin secreting tumor that is very commonly found in small intestine and also in pancreas. To lesser extent, it can also involve the stomach mucosa. One very important feature is the thickening or the doubling of the mucosal thickness. The mucosal thickness, the number of the cell layers of the gastric mucosa, that doubles. It can result in the hyperplasia of the mucous neck cells, these gastrinomas. Majority of the gastrinomas, they are malignant. Majority of the gastrinomas, more than 60% up till 90% of the gastrinomas, they are malignant, while rest of about 25% gastrinomas, they are associated with multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1 and they are usually benign. But majority of the gastrinomas associated with Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, they are malignant in nature. Gastric polyps, the main topic of discussion in this lecture. There are three important types of the polyps: inflammatory polyps, fundic gland polyps and adenomas. Inflammatory polyp, they are the most important and constitute the major portion of all the gastric polyps. Up to 75% of all the gastric polyps, they are inflammatory in nature. They are usually associated with H. pylori infection, and the common age group in which the gastric polyps, they are seen, that is old age group, 5th and 6th decade of life. These inflammatory polyps, as they have strong association with H. pylori, so they develop in association with this chronic gastritis, and especially when they are associated with H. pylori infection, when treatment against H. pylori or H. pylori eradication therapy is started, these inflammatory polyps, they can regress. Majority of the polyps, they have a small size and the diameter that is usually less than 1 centimeter. However, they can be multiple in number, they can be single in number. Usually they have a very smooth surface, although as a result of H. pylori infection, as a result of ulceration, the mucosa, it can be eroded, but overall the surface of the inflammatory polyp, that is usually smooth. This is the microscopic picture of gastric inflammatory polyp. One very important feature of the gastric inflammatory polyp is the presence of these dilated glands. You can see in numerous dilated glands, especially in the lower part of the picture. These are the cystically dilated glands, and they are lined by elongated foveolar cells. The foveolar cells, they are elongated as compared to the normal tall columnar epithelium. The lamina propria or the stroma, that is typically edematous. And why it is edematous? Because there is presence of the inflammatory cells, and that inflammation, it will result in development of the edema. Surface, it can ulcerate. So most important feature being the presence of these cystically dilated glands, which are lined by elongated foveolar cells. Fundic gland polyps. Fundic gland polyps, they are usually associated with familial adenomatous polyposis, and they can also occur sporadically. They are usually associated with judicious use of proton pump inhibitors, PPIs, omeprazole, esomeprazole, very commonly used drugs in our Pakistan. In fact, each and every patient who visit a hospital, he or she may already be using some kind of PPI due to some stress-induced ulcer, due to various NSAID use, or just as a routine matter that I am taking a lot of medication, so PPI is necessary. So fundic gland polyps, they are very commonly associated with proton pump inhibitor therapy, because these drugs which inhibit the proton pump, they inhibit the acid secretion. When the acid production, that is decreased, the gastrin secretion, that is increased, and when the gastrin secretion, that is increased, it will result in hyperplasia of the oxyntic cell. It will result in growth of the oxyntic glands or the oxyntic cells. As a result, various polyps are formed, and these polyps, especially in the fundus, and these polyps are called as fundic gland polyps. These are the microscopic features. The fundic gland polyps, they usually occur in the body and fundus of the stomach, and very commonly associated with these proton pump inhibitors. They can be single or multiple. Another important feature, just like the previous inflammatory polyp, that is the cystically dilated glands. But compared to the previous inflammatory polyp, in which I told you that these cystically dilated gland, in case of a inflammatory polyp, they were lined by elongated foveolar cell, while in case of this fundic gland polyp, the cystically dilated gland, they are lined by flattened cells. The cells, they may be parietal in nature, or they may be chief in nature. So towards the left right lower corner, you are seeing a cystically dilated gland, and just compare the lining of this gland with the other glands. The other glands, they have this tall columnar epithelial lining with the nuclei present towards the basal region, while in this cystically dilated gland present in the right lower corner, you can see that the lining epithelial cells, they are flattened. So this is the important difference that separates the fundic gland polyp from last in the list is the gastric adenoma, that represents almost 10% of all the gastric polyps. Their frequency, that increases with the age, and usually again the patients, they are in their 5th and 6th decade of life. They occur on the background of chronic gastritis, just like the inflammatory polyp, that also occur on the background of this chronic gastritis, especially the H. pylori associated gastritis. The adenomas, the incidence of these adenomas, that is increased in familial adenomatous polyposis. The patient who are having this FAP syndrome, familial adenomatous polyposis, coli syndrome, they tend to have increased incidence of this gastric adenomas. Similarly, these gastric adenomas, they can exhibit dysplasia, they can exhibit the intestinal metaplasia. So ultimately, the risk of carcinoma in case of gastric adenoma, that is increased. These gastric adenomas, they are usually solitary in nature, and the size that is large as compared to the inflammatory and the fundic gland polyp, and it can reach up to 2 cm in diameter. And common location of these gastric adenomas, that is antrum. Fundic gland polyp, they are present in the body and the fundus. The gastric adenomas, they are located in the एंट्रम। इन्फ्लेमेटरी पॉलिप्स दे आर ऑल्सो लोकेटेड मेनली लोकेटेड इन द एंट्रल रीजन। Majority of the adenomas, as I already pointed out, that there is increased risk of carcinoma, so and they are associated with intestinal metaplasia. So the majority of the gastric adenomas, they are lined by intestinal type of the columnar epithelium, and that columnar epithelium, it can have varying degree of dysplasia. Dysplasia can be low grade and dysplasia can be high grade. Ab usko we further divide on the basis of the nuclear enlargement, on the basis of cellular enlargement, on the basis of stratification. Stratification meaning the various, the number of the layers of the cells. Then comes the hyperchromasia and the crowding of the glands. So these are the various parameters, various characteristics on which we can label as high grade and low grade dysplasia. High grade dysplasia and low grade dysplasia, things they will be same, but in high grade dysplasia there will be more severe atypia. The cells, they will be more large, the nuclear hyperchromasia will be more, the cells will be more anaplastic, cribriform appearance of the glands will be more, the glands will be seen budding from one gland to other. Well, all these features will be less in the case of low grade dysplasia. So this is a picture of a gastric adenoma. You can see in the a large polyp that is present towards the right side of the picture, various glands, they are seen to be budding from one another. Various glands ek dusre se nikal rahe hain. This is budding, and then the glands, they are tightly packed together in a small space, and this is called as crowding of the gland. So gastric adenomas, they carry an increased risk of gastric adenocarcinoma. So this was the lecture about the gastric polyp. In the next lecture we will discuss the two important tumors that affect the gastric mucosa. One is gastric adenocarcinoma, and second is carcinoid. Apart from the carcinoid, lymphoid tumors or the lymphoma, that is also present. Gastrointestinal stromal tumor is also important. So they will be discussed, I think, in two lectures or so, the most important being the gastric adenocarcinoma. Thank you very much.